أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله. إن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. اللهم أجرنا من النار وأدخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار. اللهم يسر أمورنا وأمور أخواتنا الحاضرات والغائبات الصغيرات والكبيرات الذكور والإناث. اللهم بارك لهن ولأهاليهن ولأزواجهن وأولادهن وآبائهن وأمهاتهن يا رب العالمين. والله سبحانه وتعالى bless our gathering, our sisters, their family, their children, their offspring, their parents, every and each one of us, inshallah تعالى. May Allah bless your time and give you barakah in your time, in your life, in your wealth and your health. Amin ya rabbal alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect us all together in the side of a circle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and under his shade and standing on manabir, standing manabir min nur, looking at each other and remembering. You remember this Zoom wasn't working, right? And this and that. Those are facts. Inshallah we can talk about it. Because there is one hadith about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he heard that a group of people planning to send 100 men to come to hunt Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the city of Medina. And he told them, whoever bring me the head of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I will give him big prize. And that is Khalid al-Hudayl. And al-Hudayl, their big family, subhanAllah, they're well known till now in Arabia Saudi from Mecca. So, but Khalid al-Hudayli, he was a poet, he was a very well known, and he has a huge gang, like his gang leader. So he offered this 100 men to go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the city of Medina, all the way to assassinate him. Allah. So the news spread out, of course, even if it does not come from the human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the news to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through Jibreel alayhi salam that there is such a plan, right? So the news came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that somebody wants to come and cut his head, beheaded, and the head has to go to return to Khalid al-Hudayl to Mecca. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat down and he said, who will go and get me the head of Khalid, the same man who's planning for his head to be beheaded, subhanAllah, and take it to Mecca? So one of the companions, probably you never heard his name, because this is subhanAllah, there is so many great men and women in the companion time, right? In the Sahabi time and Tabi'een, as we talked last week. But subhanAllah, maybe they did one act. And that's why we don't hear much about them, like Khalid ibn al-Walid or Abi Bakr al-Siddiq or Umar al-Khattab or many other names, right? So this name probably we heard it once and that's it. And his name, Abdullah bin Uwais. He sat down, he said, Ana ya Rasulullah, I'll go to Mecca and I will bring you the head of Khalid. And he looked at him, he said, do you know Khalid, how he looks like? He said, no, I have no idea who's Khalid, but I'm going to do the job. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told the companion, whoever knows Khalid, just describe for him. So when you go to Mecca, he will know. So they told him, he's eloquent, he's a poet, he knows how to come up with a poetry from his own head. He does not repeat and memorize other people's words. He's rich. He has a huge, you know, group of people who they listen to him. He's a leader, right? In his tribe in Mecca. So that said, he said, that's good enough. So what happened is Abdullah bin Uwais, he also is a poet. Sometimes he memorize other people's, sometimes he make his own. So he went all the way to Mecca. Just before he entered Mecca, he dressed up like a Bedouin and he had his stick with him and he had his head cover, and he entered a gathering around the Kaaba in Mecca. This is before the returning of Mecca to Islam, of course. And then people looked at him. He said, oh, I am a Bedouin man. I just lost my camel. Can anyone help me if the camel came here through Mecca, through the city? I'm stranger. I don't know nothing about the city. And people looked at him. They said, yeah, we don't know you. What's your story? So when he told them, you know, what is this gathering for? Why is so many people around, you know, this one individual. They told him, oh my God, we're listening to such a poetry and we don't have time to help you, but ya akhal Arab, you know, the Arabian, they have to look like so generous and so respectful to the stranger. They told him, stay with us tonight. We will take care of you. We will host you. Then tomorrow we will send out men with you to look for your camel. No problem at all. So he was very happy. He stayed and he listened and everything. So he started coming close and he knew that the speaker around all these men gathering him is Khalid al-Hudayl, the one he wants to, you know, bring his head to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he started coming close to him, coming close to him. He stood very close to him. Then the night time coming and people has to leave. And the people who met him said, come over, you know, whatever your name, come over. We'll host you. But he looked at Khalid and he said, no, I want to stay with your leader, because I really stranger and I don't trust nobody, but the leader I can trust. So Khalid, he said, why are you going to come stay with me in my house? Just go by somebody. He goes, no, I listen to your poet and I would love to entertain you all night. You don't even have to sleep. So I want to come to you and I'm going to make you hear all my beautiful poet. And the guy, of course, you know, if that's his style, he said, okay, we have a deal. So he went with him and they start, you know, he say a poetry and then Khalid will say a poetry. Then Abdullah will say something and the other one says something. You know how it's going on today, the rapping. You know, when there's competition between rapping, sometimes, you know, neither make me watch them. Somebody say and somebody rather way answer them from the head. It's beautiful. It's entertainment too, right? So after such time, Abdullah, he said, we get so tired and so thirsty. Khalid, he said, you know what? Let's go to sleep. We have enough wording and we have enough saying. Let's just, you know, rest tonight and tomorrow we'll see what happens. So Abdullah say himself, they went to sleep, but he can't sleep because, you know, he has job to do, right? And Khalid start making noise because he's sleeping. So when he fell into the deep noise, he said, wallahi, I took my sword and I went to him. I chopped his head off. I put it in the bag. And it took him 10 days to return also from Mecca to Medina walking. So he came, it took him, I forgot to say that, coming also took him 10 days. And he said, it was so hot weather. I used to sleep at night. No, I used to walk at night and sleep daytime. So returning the same he did. He left with the head in the bag and he said at night he will walk, at daytime he will take some nap till he reached Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he throw the bag to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, I got you the head as you promised me. Now you said, whoever get the head of Khalid to me, paradise for him. He said, is paradise mine now? Am I going to paradise? He said, wallahi, you and the stick you have in your hand, you are entering paradise. You are the only one who will walk on that stick in Jannah as a reward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised, and you are going to Jannah just for that reason. So we started with the story just to show you how the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They will do anything to earn paradise and to earn the pleasant of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? So today's class, we're going to talk about our beloved Bilal, Mu'adhin Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Mu'adhin of the Prophet, the one who called for the time of the Salah. While I was reading the study, Doctora Maysoon was asked, I remember the story you gave me named Bilal, right? It was riwaya. It was written in Arabic, but it was a very beautiful, beautiful written. So subhanAllah, even the scholar was saying that Bilal became such a famous name. Muslim and non-Muslim people use it today. Muslim people love to, you know, use Bilal as their son's name. And also non-Muslim people also love to use the name of Bilal. Because Bilal is such a figure, and inshallah, you all know who's Bilal, but inshallah ta'ala, together we can just talk a little bit about his life and about the significant, because he was insignificant. How Islam is such a just, adl. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command us to be justice, and ihsan is to be beautiful in acting way. equally treating the people beyond the status of life, the money that people have, the lineage people have. Islam and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam practices how we treat all the people of faith in a such a beautiful way. So there is no human rights in the world will handle a human issue like this the way Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam handled his sahaba radiallahu anhum ardahum. So Bilal was born actually right after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam 10 years after Aam al-Fil, the year of the elephant, the year where al-Habasha, right, decided to destroy al-Kaaba, right, when they came on the elephant. And when that group of people who came, Abraha, right, he came from Yemen, and when he was trying to come to Mecca to destroy Mecca, they were defeated by the birds, right? أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ سُورَةِ الْفِيلِ in the Quran. So when they were defeated, whoever can run away, whoever died because of the birds stone them, died. Whoever survived, they were taken as a slave by that Arab. This is before Islam. From that time, the mother of Bilal was taken as a slave. But her originally also was taken as a slave, so she's a slave herself, was a slave taken from Al-Habasha, Ethiopia. That's why when we say Bilal Al-Habashi. But his mother came with the people who came from Yemen, the Christian, who they came from Yemen, and they came to destroy Kaaba because he built his own temple in Yemen, and he wants to people to come there and celebrate, right? In his town, subhanAllah, didn't happen. So the mother of Bilal was there, and after certain years, I guess she married or she has a baby, and this baby, Bilal, born as a slave. So naturally he was born as a slave. Described as a huge man, a huge and tall, extremely tall, says, probably, yani, if somebody extremely tall in Arabia, we say two meter. 2 meter is like 6 feet and 5 inch, something like that. He was big, he has a big eyes, he has a big shoulder, he has a big lips, but he was extremely handsome. You know, some people are maybe in Africa, when you describe them as black people, you might imagine like all black people look the same, somebody who in your head, like they're not that good looking, maybe. Maybe some people's mind set up that good looking people has to be a blonde hair, straight hair, color eyes, fair skin. You know, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, right? That's what the Arabia say. And subhanAllah, that's what the Arabs say, the human, the people say, everybody say that. It's in the eye of the beholder. So if I see something is as beautiful, maybe somebody else don't see that as a beautiful. But in general, Bilal, you know, has that personality, huge, big, you know, big body for men is a beauty, right? He was such a beloved man. He was beloved young man when he was growing as a slave. And who owned him? It says Abdullah Jad'an bin Jad'an. Abdullah bin Jad'an, one of the wealthiest men in Mecca. He had at that time more than 100 slave men alone. So imagine the 100 slave men, they're not tied up and chained like a jail sitting in a corner. No. The 100 slave men are hardworking, whether they're shepherd men, they're taking the care of the business, they're taking care of the maybe the farming, maybe traveling, maybe caravan trip, right? So when we say slave men, I mean, they're doing labor, they're working. So imagine somebody has 100 or a little bit more than 100 men. So how much rich is that man, right? So then after 10 years, right, of Aam al-Fil, what happened? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. And after 4 years, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became what? Became a prophet. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became a prophet, 4 years old, Bilal was 30 years. Right? 30 years old is like a Rayan al-Shabab, we say in Arabic. Yani he is the peak of the youth. 30 years old men are yani strong, tough, healthy, wise, everything you can imagine about, you know, it's not underage, it's not premature, or it's not old man. 30 years old is very beautiful. By the way, the men in paradise can be 30, 33 years old in Jannah, because that's the year Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for people to be in Jannah, to enjoy the happiness and the ni'mah and the blessing in paradise. So when once upon a time, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was taking a business caravan. This is before the Ba'tha, before the Islamic Ba'tha, right? And Umayyah bin Khalaf, how he end up with Bilal, will tell you in a minute. But Umayyah at the same time, he sent Bilal also for a business trip to do some trade business. But they met together with Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr is a master of his people. It's Sayyida Qawmihi. He's a very well known, he's rich, he's a famous. His own tribe, the one who used to save other people debts. Like if somebody in trouble, they can't pay back their debt and they're gonna get killed or something happen, they will come to the tribe of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and his father and grandfather and his lineage, that was their job. That's how rich they are. They just pay your debts without asking. It's not the lending you. It's like a bank today. You know, you need money, you go to the bank give you money, you pay them back. So it's not you're paying back the family of Abu Bakr, subhanAllah. Look how generous they were. And we know now, we wonder why Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was extremely generous when he came to Islam. So that's how Bilal and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, for the first time they met, they became as a friend. And as a slave man working with a master, even though the two business are for the two richest men in Mecca, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq respected Bilal a lot. He did not, because subhanAllah, Abu Bakr before Islam, he was such also humble, respectful, honorable man. He never looked as arrogant, superpower, right? Disrespecting other people, separating himself from the poor or slave, no. So they get together as a friend and they loved each other. And Bilal, I mean, it became Abu Bakr al-Siddiq his icon. He loved him so much. So that trip business over. Now we know that Abu Bakr and Bilal, they know each other very well. Let's come back to Jad'an, the owner of Bilal. The owner of Bilal with other 100 slave men, when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and he announced to be a Muslim, a prophet. Now people of Mecca start talking, oh my God, he's calling himself to be a prophet. He's going to condemn our goddess. He's going to take the power away from us, you know, keep Kibar Quraysh, the elite or the big fan name, the big names of Mecca start wondering, maybe Muhammad wants to take this power away from our hand to go to his hand and to control us. That's the way they took it. Subhanallah. So Islam starts spreading, right? Slowly in the beginning, but whoever entered Islam at the first few months, it was well known that they convert to Islam. It was not a place to hide. So because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will come to around the Kaaba and he will call the people, he called loudly also. He said, you know, you have to believe that I am the messenger of God. You have to believe that there is no God but Allah, which is la ilaha illallah. And you have to believe I am the last messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you remember they said, his own uncle, he said, tabban laka ali hadha jama'atana. You gathered us here to the mountain, on the mountain of Safa. To tell us you are the messenger of God, why you? So tabban laka mean woe to you. His own uncle get mad. I'm gonna listen to my nephew, just like that. And subhanAllah, we know that the first family who accepted this Islam, this beautiful religion, beautiful religion, Allahumma salli ala nabi. Okay. It was the family of Ammar, Yasir, Sumayya, and Ammar, right? Three of them, son and his parents. And they have to announce, even though Sumayya was working by Umayyah bin Khalaf himself, and her husband was working, they were very poor. They were very poor. And Ammar was a young man also. So they announced that Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So the master starts, Umayyah bin Khalaf himself start beating up Sumayya. We know she even died, right? Under the torture of her master. Subhanallah. So Abdullah bin Jad'an, he said, oh my God, I have 100 slaves. If they're going to start following Muhammad, which is seems to me the poor people start following and believing into this message, I'm going to be in trouble. And I don't want to go through, tell them, don't do this, do this. You know, listen to me, I'm your master, and start doing what Umayyah bin Khalaf was doing. He decided to let all the slaves go away. He told them, just go, you're free. Just like that. he doesn't care. He's rich. He has money, but he didn't want headache to come to his head, neither he wants to come to Islam. So when that happened, he kept only Bilal. Why? Because Bilal was one of his best slaves, as a trustworthy, a power, a young, right, healthy. Why would he let him go? He didn't let him go. Then one day, Bilal radiallahu anhu was having the sheep right around a mountain. His work, you know, he's working as a shepherd man for Jad'an, the son of Jad'an. Then he saw Abu Bakr and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming, walking through this valley, and they climbed a mountain and they sat by the cave and they're talking. And because you remember, I said Bilal knows Abu Bakr Siddiq, he figured that is Muhammad. People talking about him. So he started coming with his sheep very close to this, the place where the two friends were sitting together. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looked at him from far. He said, young man, come close to us. So Bilal radiallahu anhu, okay, get close to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He told them, do you have a shat? Shat mean lamb, so we can milk it to drink. He goes, all this lamb are for my boss, but one of them is mine. But mine really is weak and doesn't have much milk. So the Prophet said, bring it to me anyway, if you let us to milk it. So Bilal went and he brought his own. Look how trustworthy also, even though he's slave. He didn't want to just give him any, the best of the shat, the best of the lamb. He can bring it to him, but it's not his, right? He's doing the job as a slave man. So he brought his own, even though it's weak, looks like no milk. So he brought it to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet touched him and he started milking. He milked it and he drank. Abu Bakr Siddiq drank. He gave it to Bilal, he drank. Then Bilal said, wallahi, when he returned the sheep to me, he still have milk as full as when I saw the Prophet touched his hand to this, subhanAllah, to this lamb. And he was impressed with that. Then he just about to walk away, first day. The second day, again, Bilal wants to hear what they're talking about. He come close to them, and then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will call him the same, will tell him, bring your shat, and they will drink milk for 3 days. The third day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam invited him to Islam. He told him, don't you like to be Muslim? Don't you like to believe in la ilaha illallah? There is no God who deserves your worship, your deity, but Allah, and I am the messenger of Allah. And immediately Bilal radiallahu anhu said, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa annaka ya Muhammad Rasulullah. See, he accepted Islam. And the minute that happened, the next day, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was going around the Kaaba and he wants to enter the inside the Kaaba, Kaaba door used to be open. And when he entered, Bilal jumped and he walked inside with him and he started spitting on the goddess. He spit on, remember the Kaaba before, you know, Islam came back to Mecca, it was full of idolatries. It was inside and outside. And then Bilal walked in and he spit on this goddess and he says, Alaykum al-la'na, may God curse on you, you and worshiper. Wallahi, you're no use, you're no use. You're not gonna bring any goodness or any harm to anyone who worship you. And he's cursing the gods. Then who saw him? Saw him, Quraysh. You know, Quraysh, the Kibar Quraysh, those men who sit usually around the Kaaba and watching Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he used to pray or he used to do tawaf. And when they saw Bilal, they said, wow, if the slave Bilal became Muslim, his master, right, Abdullah bin Jad'an, must be Muslim now. Wow, let's go find the truth. They ran to him, among of them, Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, Umayyah bin Khalaf. They all rushed to the house of Abi Jad'an, knocking the door. Ya Abdullah bin Jad'an, come out. He came out, what's going on? He goes, Asabat, they told him. Asabat in Arab mean, did you leave the worship of the idol to worship, you know, the God of Muhammad? He swear with the Lat wal Uzza that, no, I did not do sabat. I did not convert to Islam. What's going on? They said, we saw your slave, Abed Bilal, spitting on our goddess, condemning them, and he's saying, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. He goes, La, I have no idea. I did not do it. I am not Muslim. I did not accept Muhammad as the messenger of Allah. Wallah. He starts swearing. So when they left, Bilal came back to him. When Bilal came back to him, he said, I'm going to let you go. But wait, before I let you go, let me ask my friend, Umayyah. Maybe he will use you. Let me just give it to him, just like that. So he called Umayyah bin Khalaf. He told him, take this slave man. He's no use for me. I let the other 100 go anyway for free. Would you like to take him? He said, yeah, I'll take him. I'll teach him a lesson. So Umayyah bin Khalaf took him, and that's when he starts punishing Bilal radiallahu anhu and torturing him so much, because now he became the direct master. And subhanAllah, you know, some people don't care if their slave became Muslim or not. Like Abdullah bin Jad'an did not torture anyone. But look at now the picture of Umayyah bin Khalaf. It just reminds you some of those emperor leaders, the zalimin, the aggressive, the some of the general in army or a religious setting. I don't know how they punish and they imprison some people and they torture them. SubhanAllah, if you read the history. So Umayyah bin Khalaf took over, and he started even with his hand. He did not ask any other worker or a maid or anybody for him to beat up Bilal, but he did it with his hand. You know, subhanAllah, sometimes we say, if you want to fight, you got to fight somebody who equal you, whether it's status, life status, power, right? Strength. This is a slave man. This is a master of his people. And this master go to the level of the slave, right? And he torture him and beat him up with whip him with his own hand, with his own hand. That was really a shame to do it by Umayyah bin Khalaf. But on the top of that, he will, you know, give him an armor, cloth made of iron. He will wear it on him, and then he will tie ropes on his hand, on his leg, on his neck, and he will pull him on the street. Then he calls the young men and the young children on the street, and he will tell them, pull this rope and drag him across the city of Mecca. Let's all the people make fun on him because he disobeyed his master. And they will pull him, they will torture him. And then when the sun become at the middle of the sky, which is the most hardest moment in the Arabian, they will put the stone, huge stones by 10, 20 men, they will carry it and put it on the chest of Bilal, and they will hammer him on the top of that. SubhanAllah. It says in the history of Islam, even though so many people been tortured because they convert to Islam, but no one was tortured as Bilal radiallahu anhu. And it says Bilal's father was originally prince from Al-Habasha. So he is really a son of prince. He's supposed to be a prince, SubhanAllah. But this is the life he grew up. His mother was taken as a slave woman. Then he was born as a slave. And now he is being tortured at the age of 30, 31. For the entire year, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam will pass and will see him tortured. And as we know, only 7 people accepted in the beginning Islam. And those 7 people, they were accepted Islam loudly. Everybody in Mecca knew that they were convert. Later on, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam started asking the people, let's do it in secret. We don't want anybody to know that you're convert to Islam, because they're going to torture you. But those 7 people are the following. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a Muslim, right? We're talking from them, you know, beside Khadija, radiallahu anha. It says Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, then Bilal, then it says Ammar, right? And Yasir from the men, and then Khabab. And Khabab also was a slave man, and Suhaib. Suhaib also, he was a slave, but he was not slave by Arabia in Mecca. He ran away from the slavery he lived in a Roman in Damascus. right? That's why we call him Suhaib al-Rumi. He's originally Arabi. We talked about Suhaib al-Rumi in one of our classes. So they call him al-Rumi because his Arabic language was very bad. He barely spoke Arabic. He started learning Arabic because he ran away from the Roman. When they slaved him from the Arab tribe, he grew up in the palace, but he did not like what was going on about Christianity. He did not like what the priest was doing. So he ran away, he came to Arabia. That's how when he was in Mecca, he was one of the early people who accepted Islam. Radiallahu anhum ajma'in, subhanallah. Those are the seven people, and we know Khabbab was being tortured a lot. He used to come crying to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to ask him, would you make dua and supplication for us, because for this painful and harm, what we go through, to be lifted by Allah, you are the messenger of Allah, ya Rasulullah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, just like he said to Ammar, sabran ala yasir, fa inna ma'adakum al-jannah. Be patient, if you die, you will go straight to Jannah, right? So subhanAllah, he told Khabbab, be patient, people before you who accepted Allah to be their Lord, been tortured and they've been so cut. While they were alive, they sliced them from the top to the bottom while they were alive. And they had patience and they died. They went to Jannah, inshallah ta'ala. So this is not as big as some people of Bani Israel also being tortured by their kings because they accepted Islam and they accepted God to be their Lord. Subhanallah. So let's see what happened with Bilal now. So one day when Bilal was under the sun and Umayyah bin Khalaf was on top of him, whipping him. So Umayyah, he knows Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, even though Abu Bakr as-Siddiq accepted Islam in the very, very early, right? He came to Umayyah, he said, why don't let this poor man go? Why you torture him that much? You're a master. You're a rich man. You're a famous. Why would you do that to the slave man? Then Umayyah laughed at him. He said, would you like to buy him? I will sell you. He said, yes, I will buy him. He goes, okay, give me 9 dirham. 9 dirham is like a $9 today. It's a very cheap money. It's very cheap. And immediately Abu Bakr took the 9 and threw the bag to Umayyah and he told him, let him go. And Umayyah started laughing. He said, yeah, Abu Bakr, if you bargain with me and you told me, give me one dirham, I will let it go. Because he's not useless. He's not going to listen to you. He doesn't obey his masters. Well, you know, but you gave me 9. So he thinks he's so happy. He got, you know what Abu Bakr said, radiallahu anhu? He said, wallahi, if you ask me for 100 dirham, I will give you 100 dirham. You ask for 9, I gave you 9. So what you think it's so cheap by you, in another word, very important, he's going to be very important because he's a human being. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when he accepted Islam, he just ran from day one to do good deed. That's all he has to do. Just do good deeds, spread this Islam, and that was it. And imagine Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the one, he was a reason for who come to Islam, Uthman bin Affan to come to Islam, and so many others, big leader, big figures. Uthman bin Affan accepted Islam before meeting Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because him and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq were buddy-buddy. In a business wise and friendship. When he went, he told him, I accepted this message. You know, I accepted Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a messenger of God. He told him, oh, me too. If you accept that, I accept. I don't have to go ask Muhammad. Then he brought him to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Uthman Aslam. I mean, so many other people also. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's personality, we talked a lot about him before too. He did not just hunt rich people and famous people to bring them to Islam. Sometimes we think that way. Oh, this president and that leader and that famous and that movie maker, if they come to Islam, will be so nice, right? Yes, but at the same time, are we thinking about maybe insignificant a person in jail to come to Islam or somebody who worked on the street as a cleaner, you know, a janitor to come to Islam? Are we spending time to do da'wah equally likely with the people who we in our mind that they're maybe they're low class, or are we spending our time to do da'wah for the people who they have higher status in their society and they have full pocket of money? Allahu alam, right? But Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did not see a difference whether he bring Uthman bin Affan to Islam or Bilal to Islam, because his job was freely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. So when he got him, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, this is أطلقه في سبيل الله. I bought it, but he's free. It's not he bought it to be his slave. He freed him. عتق رقبة. He freed him. That's the bottom line. So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, from that time and on, he was always Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him a lot of attention. So let's accelerate the time now. I come to the city of Medina. They left Mecca and they came to the city of Medina, and we have Ghazwat Badr, right? Ghazwat Badr. Now, people of Quraysh coming, and they're going to meet the people of Al-Muhajirin wal-Ansar. They gathered around Abar Badr, and this is the second year of Al-Hijrah, and this is the first time Kuffar Quraysh decided to come and end this messenger, right, and this prophethood in Medina. So when they decide that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called for jihad. Bilal was the first one. He never let down Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for one moment. So he was the first one to come and fight side by side in Ghazwat Badr. So Bilal telling us now, while they were fighting, when the two army met, he saw Umayyah ibn Khalaf face to face. That's his master, previous master, ex-master. The minute he saw him, he went to him and he screamed to his face. He said, Wallahi, I want to kill you right now to end this aggression. You've been using it against all the believers and against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, against Islam. And he said, Wallahi, I don't want to kill you to take revenge, personal revenge, something between me and you. But this revenge is you and Islam, you and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he went to his face, and when he put his sword in his chest, it says, Umayyah screamed, loud screaming, the people on the war, on the one who's fighting, and the people, his voice reached Medina, and his voice was so loud, no human being yelled and screamed as loud as Umayyah when he was dying. And he died with the hand of Bilal, radiallahu anhu arda. Subhanallah. So now, when they finish, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the second year, right after the Ghazwat Badr, now we know that now establishing the Salah. So Umar ibn Khattab and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they said, the time of the Salah, it's very hard to decide what time we're going to come, when it start, when is the end. It's very hard for us to decide. Would you just use something, announcement? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gathered all his companions. He said, what do you think? How are we going to announce for this Adhan? So they said, we know the Christian people came from Yemen, or they used to travel to Sham. They know the Christian, they have the bell, right? They, they ring the bell, that's time for Salah. And the Jewish in Medina, they said they have to use a horn. And when they blew in the horn on Saturday, they come for the Salah. And some other who come from Persia, they use drum. When they drum, it's time for Salah or whatever praying. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't like this idea, that idea, that idea. So he told all the companions, okay, let's decide tomorrow. Let's, everybody think, come with different idea. Some people said, we'll raise white flag. Okay, on the top of the building, they built the Masjid of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his house. And so many ideas came. But subhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told them, okay, let's see tomorrow what come. Now tomorrow come, and here it says, one of the companion, again, maybe you will hear this name, just like in the beginning, we talked about Abdullah, what was his name? The first one. You see, his name is not mentioned many times, that's why you forgot fast. The one who got the head of Khalid, his name Abdullah bin Uwais. Maybe that's the only time you're going to hear his name. Now, another companion, his name Abdullah bin Zaid. The next morning came, all right, they went to sleep. Morning came, Abdullah bin Zaid running to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I have a dream. So who had the dream? Abdullah bin Zaid. That's a different person. He said, I have a dream. I was walking at night because subhanAllah, he was thinking how he gonna come up with idea, right? For time to Sunday. So he's holding fanus. He's holding like a lamp, and this lamp is lit the light is on. And while he's walking, he's shaking. He said, two men approached me in his dream, and he told him, what is that for? Why are you shaking? Why you have that lamp on and we're shaking? He goes, yeah, I want to call for time for Salah. People, when they see, they're going to come pray. So the two men told him, oh, we let you know something better than this. And he told them, what's better than this? He told them, say this. And they read, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Hayya ala salat, Hayya ala al-falah, Hayya ala al-falah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilallah. 12 sentences. So Abdullah bin Zayd woke up, but he was so worried he's going to forget the words till he rushed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he sat by him and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have a dream, I have a dream. So he told him the dream. And he said, do you remember what they told you, the two men? He said, they told me this. So he repeated the adhan. While he's calling like this, Umar ibn al-Khattab running. And he entered and he sat, he's listening. And when he finished, Abdullah bin Zayd, he finished what he has to say. Umar bin Khattab said, Ya Rasulullah, I have the same dream. I dreamt also two men approached me. They told me, say this to call up for the time of the Salah. This is so beautiful because Islam was established not only by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it was engaged, incorporated with his companions. Now, this is what's adopted. The adhan from that time till today, till the end of the world, as long as there is a Muslim calling for salah, this dream of Abdullah bin Zayd or Umar bin Khattab was adopted. Isn't it beautiful? Yani the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he could say, oh yeah, okay, I know. Or you know what, Jibreel came to me, he told me. But subhanAllah, because this religion of the 23 years is engagement. It's just like many times Umar ibn al-Khattab will say words and subhanAllah, it will come down as ayat from the Quran. And that's the beauty of the companions, and that's the beauty of this beautiful generation, the first generation of Islam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants them actually to be engaged. It's a teacher and student engaged. It's not like, you know, you're done, go home, come tomorrow, see me, nothing like that. So what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that minute? He said, wallahi, this is a beautiful Abdullah bin Zayd. But listen, قُمْ لَقِّنْهَا لِبِلَالِ, get up and teach Bilal those words. Because Bilal has أَنْدَى مِنْكَ صَوْطًا. Bilal has a voice more beautiful and more loud, more strong than yours. Yani, he did not hurt the feeling of Abdullah bin Zayd. He could say, I have the dream, I must have the honor to call her, right? Neither he was to elevate Bilal, radiallahu anhu, and give him also the right job to the right person. If somebody gonna call now with his just voice, no microphone, no loudspeakers, no electronic, right? Digit. So he's gonna just climb some hill and call for the adhan. Now imagine the city of Medina, as Islam spreading so fast, they have to hear the voice of some strong, tough man. And that man was named Bilal. So subhanAllah, it says, from day one, the first mu'adhin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Bilal, radiallahu anhu. So Bilal did the adhan of Medina. So let me just, before we talk in detail about him, Ibn Maktoum, he has no name, that's how it goes. Ibn Maktoum, he was assigned after a few months to be also al muazzin al-thani fil Medina. In case Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go out, Bilal travel with him. Bilal has to call for the salah, right? So somebody has to call for the adhan in the city of Medina. So Ibn Maktoum has to call the adhan in the Medina. Then Abu Mahzura was the first man to be assigned in the city of Mecca when Islam came back to Mecca also. So those are the first three men, what we know now. So they were assigned to call for adhan first time ever, subhanAllah. So now, It says, what's in the Adhan? Unfortunately, you know, we live in a country here. We barely hear Masajid to call. Right now, I'm not going to hear. Only my, you know, app call for Adhan. What do I have to do when I hear the Adhan? Many times we be in the Masajid. You know, Imam Abdul Hamid will come, call for the Adhan, especially women, all the children outside, they're still talking. But they don't know how important is this Adhan, maybe. So what's important is about this Adhan, sisters, is when the Adhan is calling, we have to be silent. Even if you were reciting Quran, you have to stop reading Quran and listen to the Adhan. Imagine if you're having class or Imam talking, the minute the Adhan comes, the Imam stops talking. Well, if you are doing Salah, let's say, you know, Tahiyyat al-Masjid and the Adhan going on, that's okay, that's different. But it tells you when the Adhan comes, we all have to be silenced. So subhanAllah, if you grew up in Muslim land, such Malaysia, Indonesia, Turkey, you know, Jordan, Syria, Palestine, whatever, you know, the Adhan 5 times call, and subhanAllah, everybody has to stop what they're doing, and you just pay attention to the Adhan. Because it says, when you look to the Adhan, as I just say before, it says, Ashhadu an la Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. So you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You say Allah is bigger than anything else. It's greater than the conversation we have right now. The word Allahu Akbar, indeed, greater than any, you know, simple just talking on the phone or whatever. Even if you're on the phone, you should say, hold on, the Adhan is here, right? So especially if you're talking to a Muslim, otherwise I don't know what to say, right? So that's how important it is, because it says Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, then it says Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Whoever listen to the Adhan from the heart and believe in the word Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasulullah haqqat lahu al-jannah. Paradise is yours. That moment, if you believe that the world is really, you're the one who bear witness, there is no God of Allah, as if you convert that moment all over again. So when I say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and now it's my shahada, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, then you say, Hayya ala salat, Hayya ala salat, come to pray, right? Hayya ala al-falah, Hayya ala al-falah, come to success, come to success. Then you say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, you end it that way too, also. That is al-adhan. It says, when the adhan finish, and you listened quietly, and you make a short supplication for the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it says the Prophet حقت شفاعتي له. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says حقت شفاعتي له. I'll give you intercession to save you from hellfire in the day of judgment because you listened to the Adhan, you believed in these words, and you make اللهم رب هذه الدعوة تامة. اللهم رب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة آتي محمدا الوسيلة والفضيلة والدرجة العالية الرفيعة الذي وعدته إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. As Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I know the highest peak of paradise, Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la, is under the throne of Arsh al-Rahman, that place called al-Firdaws. And the highest place called al-Wasila, that's the name of the place. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, only given to one person from Adam to the end of the world, to only one individual person will deserve that place. And the Prophet said, I wish that's me. And that's him. That is him. But what we do here in the supplication, we make dua. We said, oh Allah, give him that place. Give it to Muhammad. Give al-wasila wal-fadila to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَرْزُقْنَا شَفَاعَتَهُ يَا رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ and give us his intercession, his shafa'ah intercession in the day of judgment. So adhan is not small word. It's a big. Some scholars disagree about who is better. Is the person who calls for the adhan or the person who leads the salah? The person who leads the salah is imam. And many times in our eyes, we look at the imam are a higher rank than muazzin. Muazzin is a person who calls for the adhan. But in reality, a lot of scholars say the imam cannot pray unless the adhan is taking place. And who takes the place of the adhan is the muazzin. So he is the key of the salah. So they say we don't know who's better, right? So subhanAllah. And the hadith says that مؤذن, whoever do adhan for 12 years will enter paradise. And this hadith, it says ضعيف, but it will taken because it's a good act deed to encourage you. You know, our young men, women now, they, you know, we encourage them, not women, our young men to do adhan in masajid, to take it as a job, because masajid hire people to be the muadhan, especially in, you know, Muslim lands. I'm here too in America, you know, every masjid have muadhan and have an imam, subhanallah. And al-muadhan, it says in the day of judgment, they will have the longest neck when they come back in judgment day. And what is that reason? It says, first of all, because their voice was loud, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them long neck. Secondly, it says the people in judgment day, they will be so thirsty, as I am thirsty right now. I'm so lazy to get up to go to the kitchen and drink water. So I'm so thirsty. So they're going to be so thirsty in judgment day. It says the people who they have long neck, they're going to be less thirsty. And who they are? The muadhinun. Those the one who called for salah. You know, al-adhan is a job, you know, because you have to be on time. Prices on time. Fajr, zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. You cannot say, you know what, I'm on road, I'm shopping, I'm in Shoprite, I'm in Pathmark, or time for Salah, I could do it later. No. Your job is you have to do the adhan for the people to come to the masjid and to do the Salah. So it's 24/7 job, right? Subhanallah. But the reward is very big. And Bilal had that personality to be a pious, to be lovable, as we described him even before Islam, even though he was a slave. A lot of people loved him. Later on, the children started mocking him because it was a command and order and bribed by Umayyah ibn Khalaf. But after he came to Islam and he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was always the one who had the only permission to wake up Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it's time for salah. If they're in a caravan or traveling or in a business or in a ghazawat or in battles, right? So if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lay down, the only person who had the time and the permission to go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell him time for salah was Bilal radiallahu anhu. Then he will call for the adhan and they will do the salat. All right, after that, what happened? It says here, subhanAllah. And now there is a hukum, since we all female, how about female? Can female can call for adhan? It says, if you're alone with woman to woman, one of us has to call for adhan, just like we lead the salah. One can be the muazzin, and one can be the one who leads the salah. And if the salah is at night, Maghrib or Isha, the woman also allowed to raise their voice to do the salah, you know, as long they trust that there is no strange man to hear them. So it says, there is hukum shari'i says, if you're alone based on this hadith, because an Arabian came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his name Abu Sa'sa'a, he's a shepherd man, he said, I can't come to the salah every time, you know, when the salah comes. I am alone by myself taking care of the sheep. That's his job in the city of Medina. What should I do? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Ya Abu Sa'sa'a, call for the time. When you know the time, call, even if you are the only human being, right? Call for adhan, then do iqama, then do salah. Then he told him, everything who hear your voice, people or jinn, any human being who can hear your voice, or the jinn, alam al-jinn also, and things, the items, the trees, the stone, Allah's creation, yani the nature, can hear your voice, so the voice can go loud. So raise your voice and make it as loud as you can, because as far as you can make your voice go far, everything can hear you, will be your witness in the day of judgment that you call for the adhan. So that's why it's sunnah to raise your voice loud when they do adhan. Today, we don't need that. Today, we have electronic or electricity, whatever. But if, you know, somebody outside or somebody, they didn't have electricity before. I grew up in a village where we have one mosque only. And on the top of the minaret, it has a balcony, go around. I'm sure people seen that, right? The man will climb from inside the steps and he will come out 5 times a day and he will go around calling for Adhan, putting his hand like this, making loud, and his voice will travel with the air. It was so beautiful. I remember that. I remember because when we lost Golan Heights, I was sixth grade. So when we came to Damascus, of course, we have electricity. You know, the city of Damascus has electricity. All the masajid will call with megaphone. They're loud, but they're megaphone. But the human voice only I saw and I lived was in the village of my Golan Heights, one of the town. I don't know if anyone of you have any experience, you know, coming from a village. So we even used to look at Maghrib in Ramadan. We used to look at the minaret because the minaret was the highest, of course, in the village. Everybody will see it. Once the minute he puts the light on, the man come out. He has a lamp. We say, oh my God, it's time to eat, time to eat. The minute he say, Allahu Akbar, we were eating or drinking. I remember those. Subhanallah. Look, I'm 65 years old now. Minus what, 12? How many years ago? 50 something. It's still like today, subhanallah, so beautiful. So based on this hadith, it says, even though if the men in the house, they're gonna pray, they have to make adhan before they do salah. You have to excuse me, I'm gonna bring my drink. Assalamu alaikum. May Allah give you drink from Al-Hawd Al-Kawthar. May Allah give you drink from Zamzam, inshallah ta'ala. Inshallah, we can all have it together. Water. Tfaddalu. Bismillah.
Ameen.
All right. So now, what if you are a female, right? You're in the house, you want to pray. It says, it's good, it's sunnah. If you can do adhan yourself and do iqama before Salat Al-Fara'id. Okay. Actually, after, alhamdulillah, I did this homework, I start doing, I'm not really doing adhan by myself because I hear the adhan from the time, from my phone. But subhanAllah, I started doing al-iqama before my salat al-fara'id. I wasn't doing it before. So I should really, and our shuyukh, inshallah, Allah has mercy on them and forgive them. They should remind us also. Us too, when we pray home. You know, I know my husband or my son, if they pray home, they always do iqama. I think that's a main job, but it's no different between men or women. We also have to do iqama before we do our own salah, okay? So remember, it says, if anyone, even though you're praying, if you do your iqama, if your voice, anyone can hear you, it says the two angels on your right and left are praying with you when you do the iqama. Imagine. And when you do the adhan, as this man was, Abu Sasa was told, as far as your voice travel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation will be your witness in the day of judgment. This is the beauty of Islam. You know, in Islam, we're engaged into the nature, with the nature. The nature become engaged with you. The nature supports you. The nature and the ground you stand on it will be your witness in judgment. They will speak for you. Imagine. That's why sometimes, subhanAllah, when we pray in one area, right, when we finish, we move. We know it's a sunnah to move from place to place for two reasons. The first reason is that you break the first salah because you cannot continue salawat without saying something. When you say, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you have to say something, whether you have to say tasbih, or if you don't have that time, you just move. So that's the first sign that you broke the salah. And the second one is you want the spot to be your witness also in the day of judgment, subhanAllah. Because like we said, when the righteous people died, the earth becomes sad, says, oh, the righteous people were walking over on the top of me, such a humble, nice, kind, doing righteous things, right? And when the aggression died, they're very happy. They said he was walking on the top of me with arrogant and mischieving and this and that. They're very happy that that person died. Subhanallah. So nature is always, always with you. So don't feel lonely at all. Don't feel like, you know, nobody here, nobody sees me. We know that full of angels. The minute we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the angels come. The minute we say Adhan, angels come. Subhanallah. Okay, and this, these are all the things. Now, what happened when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam message end, and at the age of 63, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died. And that was the last time Bilal radiallahu anhu called for Adhan in the city of Medina. When he died, he died. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, became the Khalifa, and he told him, you're going to be my muazzin. He goes, no, I was a muazzin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only for Rasulullah. I'm not going to call for any adhan after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I used to call for him. So you have to excuse me with that. And Abu Bakr al-Siddiq just like felt a little sad, right? Then he told him, ya Abu Bakr, Izanli, give me a permission to leave the city of Medina. Not because I want to hide, I want to run away, I'm a coward. No, because I want to go for jihad. I want to go for jihad to the, you know, with the people who go out for fighting. So I don't have that time to stay with you like I did with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for every moment you do, for every movement. So Abu Bakr told him, no, I want you to stay in the city of Medina. And this is what he said. Bilal radiallahu anhu reminded him, he said, did you free me, right, from Umayyah to be your slave? If that's the case, I understand. I'll obey, I'll do whatever you want, ya Abu Bakr. Or did you free me liwajillah, for the sake of Allah? Abu Bakr al-Siddiq said, how could you say that? How could you say that? He said, I free you for the sake of Allah. Just go, do whatever you want to do. As much as he loves him to stay with him and to do the adhan for him, he lets him go. So Abu Bakr, subhanallah, Bilal left and he traveled till he was in Palestine when Umar ibn al-Khattab became the Khalifa. He was there in Palestine fighting with the side by side with the believers. So when they took over Jerusalem, you remember, the key, Jerusalem has a door. The key was in the hand of the Christian, and they didn't want to hand to the general back then. And they said, in our book written that this key has to be only given to the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the successor of Muhammad. So they sent letter to Umar ibn al-Khattab and they told him, you have to come. And you remember the story how Umar ibn al-Khattab called for his Fahri name, his one of his worker, and he told him, just bring one animal, that's all we need, one donkey. So they take turn to ride all the way from city of Medina to the city of Jerusalem. That is not close, sister. That's going to take like 10 days walking, especially on a donkey, not a running horse. All right. They took turn, one walking, one sitting, one taking. When the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab was his time to walk, they were entering the door of the city of Jerusalem. Then the army general was there of the Muslim, and he came to welcome Umar ibn al-Khattab. He looked at him. His worker is riding the donkey, and Umar ibn al-Khattab walking and pulling the donkey, and his robe, it's all mud from the top of the head. He told him, let me take you to some place, take a shower, put this nice clothes on you, because we're going to go meet the Christian leader who's going to give you the key, who's a Khalifa. And he got angry and he pushed the Sahabi. He said, we fought and we opened up the door of Jerusalem for a dunya materialistic and a clause. Is that what we are here for? Wallahi, I'm just going to meet him as is. So when they met, the priest, he told him, it's written in our book, described even how many patches in your galabiyah have. It was 27 times patched. His gown, Umar ibn al-Khattab, in his time, Islam and the wealth of Islam was coming like a crazy, as rich, they will be becoming Al-Khattab, he used one donkey, him and his maid, all the way to come to Jerusalem because he didn't want to use two animals from the Bayt al-Mal to come both of them riding. Today, if one of the religious leader, forget the Khalifa or a president, to travel from place to place, how do they travel? First class, right? Allahu a'lam. So, subhanAllah, the priest said exactly what was written in their Bible. It's fit. And this is a person we're going to give the key to Umar ibn al-Khattab. And they gave it to him. When Umar ibn al-Khattab got handed the key, it was time for Salat. I believe Salat al-Asr. And the Christian told him, come, we'll show you a place to pray. Come, you could pray in our church, right? So they opened the door of that church, which is Knesset al-Qiyama today in Jerusalem, they call it. The Resurrection Church, which is very much beautified. Umar ibn al-Khattab refused to pray inside for two reasons. The first reason, he said, no, it's okay, I'll pray by the door. So he stepped a few steps out and he stood there and he prayed there. And the first reason, he told the religious leader, I don't want to pray inside the church in case the people, the Muslimin after me, they will think that this should turn into a masjid. This church should convert into masjid because Umar ibn al-Khattab prayed here, right? He said, I don't want that to happen. Till today, that place is a church, subhanAllah. That's the toleration of Islam. Secondly, he said, I don't want to set up a sunnah that the people must come to Jerusalem and they must see where is the place of Umar ibn al-Khattab. He prayed in this kanisa or in this church. So everybody, when they come to Palestine or to Al-Quds, they're going to go there and pray as Umar ibn al-Khattab, as he did. He didn't want to establish a sunnah like that. But today, the exact place where he stood, Umar ibn al-Khattab, and he prayed his salah, they build mosque on the top and they call it Masjid Umar ibn al-Khattab. My daughter Sophia and her husband went there. It's a small mosque, subhanAllah. It's expanded in one area, but the exact place where he stood and he prayed, it's preserved. And it says Masjid Umar, side by side with that church in Jerusalem, subhanAllah. In that time, when Umar ibn al-Khattab came to pray Salat al-Asr, he called Bilal. He called, you have to call for the salah. He told him, but I promise I'm not going to call for salah after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for nobody. But he told him, wallahi ya Bilal, if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with us, he will assign you this job to do the adhan right here, right here, right here, because this place is one of the holiest place also. Remember, it was the first qibla. Jerusalem, Masjid al-Aqsa, was the first qibla of the believers. The Muslimin prayed toward 13 years, they prayed toward Masjid al-Aqsa. So come here and do the adhan. You will make Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very happy. So Bilal did adhan one time in Masjid al-Aqsa. He came and he called for the adhan. He said, everyone in the army cried so loud. They never cried as much as the second time as Rasulullah sallallahu, the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the city of Medina. So that was Bilal radiallahu anhu. And after Bilal, it says he lived 10 years in Syria, in Damascus, when Syria was opened up. That was also in the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, right? And the city was opened. So his last destination was in Damascus. But before we come to Damascus, let's come back to Medina a little bit. After Ray al-Hijra, Bilal radiallahu anhu is almost 40 years now, never been married yet, right? Because he came to Islam at the age of 30. 13 years we are migrated to Medina, so he is 43. And he has one brother, but we don't know his brother's name. He did not become as famous, but he came to Islam. And when he came, him and his brother was to get married. He said, Bilal, he tells us, he said, I went to most of the houses of the city of Medina, knocking the door. When they open the door, he will tell them, this is me, Bilal, Muadhin al-Rasul, this is my brother. Both, we were slaves once upon a time. We are Habashi from Ethiopia, we are slave. But right now, we converted to Islam. We are a Muslim. We have our own job. We earn our own money. We want to marry. Would you marry me, your daughter? Just like that. And they will say, oh, we don't have a daughter for you. And they will slam the door, and he didn't find anyone. You know, he said, I knocked almost every door in the city of Medina. Then, once upon a time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went in the masjid, and a high class lineage from the city of Medina came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brothers. And they said, ya Rasulullah, we have a sisters. And our sister is really beautiful, very, very kind, very good woman. We want a husband for her. Would you just, you know, find her a husband, right? Right? Today too, people do it. You know, if you want to marry, you say, please, you know, come to the masjid. You tell the imam, if you know family, they have a son or they have a daughter. If you're looking for a daughter or a son, you know, you want them to come Islamically. So they did the same. So this group of brothers, they came, they said, we have a sister, we want her to. So you know what he said? Alaykum bi Bilal, alaykum bi Bilal. Go to Bilal. Bilal will be fit. But they expected someone who come from a very, you know, famous lineage, you know, tribe name, you know, some honorable family before Jahiliya, after Jahiliya. I understand, right? It's their right to, you could say it's their right. They didn't say anything, they left. The second day they come, they ask the same question to Rasulullah, so find us somebody for our sister. And he tells them, alaykum bi Bilal, for three consecutive nights. The third evening, you know what he told them? Alaykum bi Bilal, fa innahu min ahli al-jannah. Go after Bilal. Bilal is a man of paradise. And when they heard that, they loved it. And they went to Bilal and they told him, would you marry our sister? And he married that girl. He married that beautiful woman. She was a very pious. She was a very beautiful. She did the migration and she did the whole jihad with her husband. Everywhere he go, she was with him. And they both died in the city of Damascus. So before she died, he got very sick. She knew that Rasulullah, you know, that Bilal, you know, he's going to die. So she came and she said, oh my God. You know, she was so scared. She said, oh my God, wa huzna. What a sad, you're dying. What a sad, you're dying, my husband, right? And he was 63 years old. And you know what he said? This is a very famous quote. He said, La taquli wa huzna. Don't say what a sad moment, I'm dying, my beloved wife. Say wa farha, what a happy time, what a happy time. You know, he said, Ghadan alqa al-ahibba Muhammadan wa sahba. Tomorrow I will meet my loved one, my loved brothers, Muhammad and his companions. He's very happy, he's dying. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us good moment, good ending. So during when the 10 years when he was in Damascus, it says, I don't know if it's true hadith, but it says in Bidayah wa Nihayah also that Bilal had a dream, radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling him, why are you so far away from us? You didn't visit me, right? Because when you visit the graveyard of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he feel it personally. So he said, ajafaitani, mean you're so far from me, Ya Bilal, why you don't come visit me? So when he woke up from his dream, he said, I gotta go visit, you know, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this city. He came in my dream. So when he came, they saw him. When they saw him, I think this was the time also of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. This is before Umar ibn al-Khattab. So when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq saw him, he said, because Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was a khalifa 2.5 years. He told him, oh my God, Bilal, you're here. Please, you know, the next adhan, you're going to call for the adhan. He goes, no, I can't. I told you, I can't call for adhan. He said, no, people will love it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will love it. He came in your dream, has meaning. So he said, okay, I will call for the adhan. So now not everyone in the city of Medina knew that Bilal is there, right? So he came to the masjid and he started calling. When he started calling and they heard his voice, people of Medina start running to the masjid and they start crying and they start crying and start crying. This is the second time also they cry so loud because they remember the only time Bilal was calling for azan when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was around. That made them so sad because they remember the moment and they missed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even Bilal radiallahu anhu could not finish the adhan because he started crying. And he broke the adhan and he stepped down and somebody else finished it. Subhanallah. In one of the Isra' wal-Mi'raj of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was walking in the heaven, right? The seven heavens with Jibreel alayhi salam. He heard like footsteps. And when he heard the footsteps and a beautiful woman voice behind the Quran. And of course, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has the tour guide, right? Jibreel alayhi salam. He told him, who is that? Whose footsteps? So he told him, that's Bilal. Jibreel talking. That's Bilal. He's walking in his garden. And that voice, beautiful woman voice, is his wife. He said, Rasulullah, he said, would you like to see it? He wants to move the curtain, Jibreel alayhi salam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, no, I moved my face. I don't want to look at Bilal's wife. So he came back, he told Bilal radiallahu anhu, what made you to be a people of paradise, ya Bilal? What so special you making? We don't know, you're doing something so special, ya Bilal, right? The Prophet asked him. And you know what he said? Wallahi ya Rasulullah, you know all my life, you know what I'm doing. I'm not doing much. But he said, I do not let myself a moment without wudu. Every time I break my wudu, I do not leave the bathroom, right? Or the private area, unless I renew my wudu. Then when I have a new wudu, I always pray two ruk'ah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that's what made you to earn your paradise. So sometimes we think, you know, earning paradise, it takes maybe battles and fighting and sacrificing your money and yourself. Yeah, it could be that one too, but it could be as easy as always stay in the state of wudu tahara, state of tahara, as Abu Bakr, as Bilal radiallahu anhu. And there is a sunnah, rukatin sunnah after wudu. When you do wudu, make that time and do short two ruk'ah, and they call it sunnat al-wudu, inshallah ta'ala. So these are the, of course, Bilal radiallahu anhu became very, he died very beloved one. He loved very beloved one by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and by everybody. One day when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting in his, you know, majlis, and on his right, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, on his left, Umar ibn al-Khattab, all the Sahabi sitting down, and Bilal coming late from somewhere, and he enters the masjid. When he enters the masjid, the circle was closed already, Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he sat in like, by the entrance of the door and by the side, by the corner, he sat by himself. Guess what the Rasulullah said? Ya Bilal, get up and come close to me. So he called him his name and he told him, come close to me. And he looked at him and he said, where am I going to come? I have no spot, right? Then he told Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, move a little bit. Make space. He moved Abu Bakr and he made space for Bilal radiallahu anhu. He said, sit by me right here. And that's how we started, how this deen is a deen of adl, deen of musawat. This is a religion of equality. This is a religion of justice. This is a religion where there is no big name and small name. The believers are brothers and sisters. Al-mu'minuna ikhwa. The believers are equal. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will love all of them at the same level. He did not want to hurt the feeling of Bilal because walked in, he has no place to sit. He sat in the corner of, you know, by the door, by the entrance. Meanwhile, he brought him all the way to the front and he pushed Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and he told him, come, squeeze yourself between me and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Radiallahu anhum wa ardahum jami'an ajma'in ya rabbal alameen. Yani, subhanallah, these are the manners, you know, how Rasulullah. Every time, you know, when you're talking about when companions and there's stories between here. But I want to say this one short story. In Ghazwat Khaybar, right? When the battle against the Jewish tribe was happening in the city of Medina, as I said, Bilal did not miss any of the battles of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was always side by side. In that day, a woman, also the children came out because Medina here and Khaybar here is just like woman. And they know this is indeed a successful battle against the Jew. So the woman and the children got up and they came, they're marching with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam behind the army men. And when the Prophet looked around, he saw a young lady, Jariya Saghira, I mean, it's a very young lady. I'm going to say like 6, 7, or maybe younger, little girl among them. And he was surprised. He was saying, what is this little girl doing here, right? So he looked at her, he said, salamu alaikum to her, and he continued his jihad. When they finished Khaybar and they took all the wealth, right, of the Jewish, they ran away and they left behind so much jewelry, so much money, so much gold. And when everything was finished, and imagine now you are the army leader, the general, he was the most important person in the army. Now that is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He grabbed one of the jewel like a necklace, and he's looking at a young girl. I saw her early in this morning. Where is she? Where is she? He left everything behind, and he's looking after that young girl. He was marching behind the men. Why? He went there and he put the necklace on her neck. He said, "This is for you." That woman lived to become old woman. She said, I never took the necklace out of my neck all my life. And she told her family, when I'm dead, you shroud me, you keep the necklace on me. Because the Prophet put it on me, I'm going to keep that. And they told her, okay, why are we going to bury it with you? This must be valuable. She told them, when I get up on the judgment day, I'm going to take the necklace, I'm going to show it to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm going to tell him, do you remember? You gave me this. Take me to paradise. Habibi ya Rasulullah. That's how he was. That's how he was with a black, white, old, young, Sahabi Jaleel, like Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, a businessman, a rich man. Bilal, as a slave, a freed man. Young lady, young... Yani, some people maybe didn't even pay attention to that young little girl running in behind the men, right? Subhanallah. But he did not neglect anyone in his community, in his society. Habibi ya Rasulullah, till he died. Sallallahu alayka Rasulullah. Inshallah, we adopt a little bit from his manners, from his attention to the young kids, like... when we talked about Asma bint Umais, also we talked about the little boy, right? Umair, subhanAllah, we talked about Umair, and we talked about the bird. Abu Umair lost his bird, and the bird died, and he was crying. We talked about that too once upon a time. So these are one of his, subhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's big heart and divided attention. He will give attention to everywhere, to the men, to the women, to the children, to the rich, to the poor as equally, to make them feel like important. And inshallah ta'ala, as much as we can talk about Bilal radiallahu anhu, we will never can give him, you know, all his rights he deserved. He died big, human entering paradise before he died. We know that he's going straight to Jannah. He was beloved, he was generous, he was brave, and he kept his honorable relationship with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his life. That's how we have to be, inshallah. We live for a reason. We have to live and do our life not only taking care of our own family, our own son and daughter and husband, and that's it. I'm a good wife, I'm a good mother, I'm a good mother-in-law, I'm a good grandma. No, we have to reach beyond that, inshallah ta'ala, right? Jazakumullahu khairan. If anything made a mistake, it's my fault. Anything was right, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah's mercy on Bilal radiallahu anhu. May Allah's mercy on all the companions. May Allah's peace and prayer on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. May Allah forgive you all, forgive us all, and bring us, resurrect us with them, with these great companions in paradise. Ya Rabbal Alameen. Jazakallah.
Jazakallah khair.
Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah khair. Add about Bilal is broken.